so great to worship with you. Let's stand together. There's a reason for our hope. There's a reason for our joy. His name is Jesus. So we lift his name above everything else. Sing this with me.
There's a reason I can see. There's a reason for this life inside me. One name above all names, Jesus. Yes, it's Jesus. There's a reason for this hope. There's a reason for this peace that I know. One worthy of all praise, Jesus. Yes, it's Jesus.
Come on, let's lift your voice.
I will lift my hands up. I will raise my voice high. I will shout of your love till the day that I die. Everything that I have, all my worship I bring. You're the reason I live. You're the reason I sing. You're the reason I live. You're the reason I sing. For the victory over sin.
Goodness and your grace. So I proclaim your glory. God, we thank you for it. We give you all the praise this morning. It's in your name. Amen.
Hey, Hey, First Ridgeland. Thanks for tuning in today. You picked a great Sunday to join us as we'll be learning the real difference between joy and happiness. We'll hear more about that in Dr. Bird's sermon later on. If you're interested in knowing more about First Ridgeland, just text First Ridgeland to 95577. We can't wait to get to know you better. Before we continue with worship, I want to let you know about some cool opportunities headed your way. First up, Live Serve Sunday is happening today at 2 p.m. and you're invited. The third Sunday of every month, everyone at First Ridgeland gets to be the hands and feet of Jesus to our community. And what better way to show God's love than by serving together? We'll be going to Park Place and Pear Orchard Apartments for games and back-to-school activities, helping put together some gifts for our local teachers and serving alongside Tony Brook and helping with the annex renovation from across the street. At 2 p.m. today, we'll meet at the CLC for prayer, resources, and final details before we all head out. And don't worry, we'll be taking extra precautions against COVID by maintaining social distancing as we serve. For more information on Live Serve Sunday, just go to firstridgeland.org/Live Serve Sunday. Next, First Things First is happening at 9 a.m. next Sunday, August 23rd, and Sunday, August 30th. If you're looking to learn more about First Ridgeland and to get plugged into True Community, then you don't want to miss First Things First. During these two sessions, we will discuss things like what we believe, our mission, as well as how you can get connected to all that God is doing in our church and our community. You'll even have the opportunity to officially partner with the people of First Ridgeland. To get more information on First Things First and sign up today, just go to firstridgeland.org/firstthingsfirst. Last but not least, we are so excited about Wednesday nights in August. Each Wednesday at 7 p.m. on Facebook Live, we will hear from real-life couples as they address real-life issues. Because let's face it, whether we are married or not, we all have a picture of what marriage should look like. And it's these hidden notions that can sometimes rob us of experiencing true love and joy. Be sure to set your alarms now to tune in this Wednesday at 7 p.m. on Facebook Live for Marriage Matters, because it's not too late and it's never too early. Now, let's get back to worship. This next song is a great reminder that salvation comes only from Jesus and that He is our constant source of hope. Let's stand and worship Him together.
King of kings calls me his own. the silence, the roaring lion declared the grave has no claim on me. Sing this with me. Then came the morning, came the morning that sealed the promise. Your buried body began to breathe.
Like Jesus. Let's read this week's verse together. The Lord knows the way of the righteous, but the way of the wicked will perish. Psalm 1:6. When we're living in righteousness, we're listening to what God is telling us to do and obeying His commands. And all of His commands can be summed up into these two things. God wants us to love Him with all of our heart, mind, and strength. And He wants us to love others as He loves us. That's it. When we do those things, the rest of our lives follow. So let's run from the ways of the world that seem to trap us, and let's ask God to enter into our everyday decisions so that we can follow His way to righteousness. Let's pray together. Dear Heavenly Father, we just ask and pray that You may come into our lives to just lead us away from the wicked ways of the world and to help us be more like You and less like ourselves. And we pray that You may just lead us to salvation. Amen.
Let's continue to sing this morning. God is our hope, is our joy. Find this in Christ alone, in His name and His resurrection. As we look to You, we look to You alone. In Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, solid crown, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are still, when striving cease. My comforter, my all in all, here in the love of Christ I stand. Oh,
King of kings, the Lord of lords. All heaven sings to Christ alone.
Hey, good morning, friends. Thank you so much for joining us via live stream. We're in week number 2 of our series, The Lies We Believe. Now, we want you to engage with us today and share with us your comments and your questions and your praises and your requests as well. Now, remember, in this series, every weekend, we're exposing a lie that has slipped into the Christian vernacular, and then we're replacing that lie with truth that is found in God's Word. And last weekend, here was the lie. We said that if life is good, then you must be in God's will. However, if life is tough, well, you must be out of the will of God. And we know that to be a lie because Scripture teaches that. As a matter of fact, Jesus even said that, listen, foxes have holes and birds have nests. The Son of Man is nowhere to lay his head. Isaiah prophesies that Jesus would in fact be a suffering servant, a suffering Messiah. And the Apostle Paul, who wrote more than one third of the New Testament, well, we know that hours after his conversion, that God told him, I'm going to show this man how much he must suffer on my behalf. So that was a lie, but here's the truth. Trials grow our dependency upon God, don't they? They do. They grow our faith muscles. They grow our dependency upon God. Okay, here's today's lie. It's a big one. God just wants me to be happy, right? I mean, who hasn't heard that lie before? And who hasn't maybe believed that lie? God just wants me to be happy. But the reality of the moment is this. My happiness and your happiness is not God's chief concern. As a matter of fact, the whole point of the Christian life is for our lives to point people back to God. But sometimes life is not easy. You know, the Apostle Paul, in 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 8, Paul said this, I do not want you to be uninformed, brothers and sisters, of the hardships that we endured in the province of Asia. Indeed, we endured beyond our ability to cope and to endure with the circumstances. We feared even for our life itself. And so sometimes we can be right in the center of God's will, and the circumstances can be, well, anything but happy. So that's a lie. Here's the truth that we're going to look at in God's Word. Joy comes from Jesus, not our circumstances. The joy comes from Jesus. Deep down, lasting joy comes from Jesus Christ, not our circumstances. Listen, you know and I know that circumstances in life are fickle at best. They're incredibly fickle. I mean, I've known men and women who've been rising on the corporate ladder year after year after year, promotion and raises and more responsibilities, all three go together, and then all of a sudden there's a downturn in the economy or a pandemic like COVID-19, and they're laid off, or worse, they lose their job. I've known men and women who are the picture of health that went in for a routine checkup with their doctor and came out with devastating news that would forever alter their life. But throughout those circumstances, Christ is what? Christ is constant. He is constant. That's why the psalmist said that we're to give praise to the God of heaven. His love, it endures. It endures forever. Did you know that the word joy is mentioned 88 times in the Old Testament and 57 times in the New Testament? It's a prevalent word that we see over and over again. And we're going to learn today that joy and happiness are a choice. They're a choice. And we can learn to find joy and happiness in the ordinary circumstances of life by allowing God to be the God of our circumstances. And our focal text today will help with that. It's a familiar one. It's Galatians 5, 22 through 23. In your Bible, you more than likely have the heading, Fruit of the Spirit. And we often think the fruit of the Spirit, we have to work on one, then we graduate to the other. But what I want you to understand about the fruit of the Spirit is we actually receive these at the moment of conversion. Now, they grow and they mature through us as our faith grows and mature. But we get these, the fruit of the Spirit, at the point of conversion. So please note that. Apostle Paul is speaking to Christians in Galatia. Here's what he says. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, forbearance, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, and gentleness, and self-control. Now watch this. Against such things, there is no law. Now, here's what I know and what you know about the fruit of the Spirit. The fruit of the Spirit is a byproduct. It is a byproduct of staying connected in our relationship with Christ, or John would say, abiding in Christ. And we're going to talk about that here in a few minutes. Okay. I want to give you two reminders today, and the first is this. Joy is a fruit of the Spirit. It is. The text says so. The fruit of the Spirit is love, then joy. Now, why did Paul start with love? Well, it's really simple. Our relationship with Christ has to be true. It has to be pure, and then our relationships with other people can be healthy. And then Paul said a close second to that is joy, because our joy points other people back to Christ. Now, what I want you to understand today is this, that God is the chief gift giver. He is the most generous gift giver on the planet. Now, there are a lot of incredible philanthropists in the world, in our country, and even in our own state. But none compare to God. Why? Well, He continues on a daily basis to give us His best. And what is that? Well, God gives us Himself. And that's the greatest news of the gospel, that at the moment of conversion, we get God Himself. We get to know Him. We get to behold Him. We get to experience Him. And we get to experience the fruit of the Spirit, His Holy Spirit, living inside of us. It's an incredible opportunity. Now, many years ago, I met a guy named Joe in college. And this is one of those guys, he just really had his act together. And one of the things that I remember about him, he always seemed to be in a good mood, a little bit too good of a mood. I mean, this guy, nothing seemed to faze him. And I just assumed that it was because, well, life was going his way. It really looked like that Joe had a tailwind wherever he went, and the favor of the Lord just followed him. I mean, he was a good-looking guy. He was a college athlete, three sports. That's right, three sports. He was crazy intelligent. Everybody liked him. It was just one of those guys where you just enjoyed being his friend. But I watched him close to see what would happen when life didn't go his way. Because one day, things changed. And I had a front row seat because I played on a traveling ball team with Joe. And I watched as a friend betrayed him. And I watched even closer when he lost a really good friend to a car accident. Now, his emotion was very appropriate for the moment, but he didn't lose his faith and he didn't lose his joy. And so I leaned into the tension of the moment and mustered up the courage to ask Joe, "Joe, you got to share with me what's going on with you." I said, "I don't understand how you have this joy, this happiness, and this holy optimism, this eternal optimism about you. I've watched you go through good times and difficult times, and it never wanes. What's the deal?" And then he quoted John 15:5 to me. He says, "Well, you know, Jesus said that I am the vine," Jesus referring to himself, "I am the vine and you're the branches. He who abides in me or stays connected to Jesus will bear much fruit, but apart from me, you can do nothing." And then Joe said this. He says, "You know, Mark, sometimes life goes your way and sometimes life does not go your way." He said, "But I've discovered through the Word of God and through life experiences that, well, God never leaves us. His word tells us that over and over again. He'll never leave you or forsake you. We know that." And then the next thing he said perhaps changed my life. He said, "So we get to choose during good times and tough times if we're going to stay connected to Christ." And then he told me how he stayed connected through the good times and the tough times. He said, "You've got to remain in prayer. You have to stay in the Word of God and journal what he's teaching you." And then Joe was involved with our version of a D group. And what he said to that day just arrested my spirit. He said, "You know, we get to choose whether or not we stay connected to Christ in the good times and in the tough times. It's nobody else's responsibility but mine and yours." And what you need to be reminded of today is that joy is a fruit of the Spirit. It is a fruit of the Spirit, and God gives you that at the moment of conversion, and it is up to you to stay connected to Him and to mature that fruit of the Spirit. And I also learned from studying the Bible that fruit is a symbol of character, of God maturing us. Fruit is a symbol of character. And some of you right now are thinking, "Man, Mark, I just want a better marriage. I want a better marriage. And I really, really need a promotion at work. Or I would love to have some solid Christian friends. Or I would like a larger influence for Christ." So here's what I would say to that today, and what the Word of God teaches me and it teaches you. That fruit is a symbol of character. Now watch this. If you want a better marriage, if you want a broader influence for Christ, if you want better friends, if you want to nail that promotion, here's what you can do. You can start by working on you and allowing God to develop His character inside of you. Because when you read the Proverbs in Proverbs chapter 1 through Proverbs chapter 4 and learning to make decisions and learning to discern where God is at work, He tells you over and over again that He reveals Himself to people of character, integrity, and righteousness. So you really want to be a joyful person? Work on your character. And God will make Himself known through you. Reminder number two. Joy doesn't depend on our circumstances, does it? It doesn't. Our circumstances at best are fickle, but Christ is constant. One of the last verses in the book of Matthew 28:20, Jesus speaking to His followers. This is after the crucifixion and resurrection. His appearance to the disciples and several hundred. He says this, "I am with you always to the end of the ages." Now let's consider the context for just a minute. These are Jesus' words to His disciples after the crucifixion and resurrection, after His appearance to the disciples and several hundred people. And then a short time later, we read the last words of Christ in Acts 1:8. And then in Acts 1:9, we have the ascension of Christ to heaven. And I can only imagine the emotions, the sea of mixed emotions for Peter, James, and John. I mean, think about it. These guys left everything. They left family and friends and occupations and status in the community to follow the Messiah, Jesus Christ, King of Kings, for 3 years. And they watched Him arrested, beaten, and crucified, and died, and then resurrected, and ultimately ascended to heaven. And now I think it's coming crashing home on them. They're realizing, oh, it's up to us to hit the streets, literally, and take the gospel with us. And one of two things was going to happen right now. Either fear or faith would prevail. Fear or faith would prevail. However, you know this because you know your Bibles. In Acts 1 and 2, who stepped up to the plate? It was Peter, the unquestionable leader of the disciples and of that first century church. And it was Peter. It was Peter that stood up and would preach an incredible sermon. It was Peter that stood up in the moment of confusion and allowed the certainty of Christ, the indwelling Christ, to guide him and not the uncertainty of the moment. When Peter stepped up before that band of 120 Jesus followers, it was Christ within him that was leading him, not the uncertainty of the moment. Listen, we all know people. We all know people who send out an SOS group text prayer request when they have a hangnail. Don't call any names. You know them. I know them. And then we all know people, others, who've overcome incredible adversity in life and nobody knew what they were going through. They just focused on the Christ in their circumstances, not the circumstances. And I want you to help me with something right now. There has been in the last 5 to 10 years a shifting in the culture of our country. And it's not just one generation. It's not just the baby boomers or the millennials or the Gen Xers. It's not just one generation of people that have bought into this. But there's been a shift in our culture the last 5 to 10 years where people, they're forever on a search and a quest for utopia and happiness at the expense of everything else. And so it looks like this. When the marriage gets difficult, boom, they bail. When things at work, when they reach a point of tension with a fellow coworker, they just quit. They peace out. When their life group or D group is not meeting their set of expectations, which sometimes can be spoken, sometimes unspoken, they jet. They hit the road. If churches don't meet their expectation, they leave. What I want to encourage you to do right now is this. Resolve in your corner of the world to focus on the Christ in your circumstances and not simply the circumstances. Because joy, deep down lasting joy, doesn't depend on our circumstances. Circumstances are good one minute and bad the next. Why? Because that's life. The stock market is up today and it's down tomorrow. Friends can make you happy today and they can betray you tomorrow. Things in life can go well. Your career can be soaring through the roof today and then a pandemic hits tomorrow and you're looking for work. That's life. Join me in choosing to focus on the Christ in your circumstances and not your circumstances alone, and you will see joy return to your life. Reminder number 3. Believe it or not, joy is a command. Paul said in Philippians 4:4, "Rejoice in the Lord again. I will say, rejoice." You know what's amazing about that verse? Is that it's written by the Apostle Paul in jail. As a matter of fact, most of Paul's writings came from jail. His circumstances were not joyful. Yet the book of Philippians, the theme, you guessed it, is joy. As a matter of fact, there are 104 verses in the book of Philippians. Over 30 times the word joy is mentioned. He even commands it. How can that be? Because Paul understood joy is found in Christ, not your circumstances. And he lived it, and he penned it, and he modeled it, and he paid it forward to the next generation. And we're blessed to have that. So understand today, wherever you may be, whether you're in a hospital room or whether you're in the living room of your home or on the patio or whether you're on vacation or whether life's going for you or against you, joy is a command. And nobody can make that choice, nobody but you. His name was Dr. Fred, and he's one of those guys that I met when I was in grad school. As a matter of fact, there were a few seminars in grad school that I really was looking forward to taking. And the reason was the presenter for the class. And in this particular class, you had what I call a color commentary team. You had the scholar, and then you had the guy who was living it out, and that was Dr. Fred. I mean, this guy was lights out, on fire for the Lord. And he was just sharing one success story after another. He did the impossible. Dr. Fred took a dying ministry in the inner city of New Orleans when the city led the nation in murders. His first couple of years in this ministry, they led the nation in murders. What a dubious distinction. And into that world of violence and crime, he brought the love and light of Jesus. And the whole country was taking note. And I was able to listen to this guy. I'm like, man, this is awesome. And he was sharing one story after another after another. And man, we're just like eating it up. And like, this is phenomenal. This is incredible. And then there came a question from the back of the room. You know, there's one of those guys or girls in every class. And they ask that question. Everybody in class is like just wanting to put their face in their heads, going, I can't believe he asked that question. But he asked it. He said, Dr. Fred, I have a question. I know you deal with a lot of heavy stuff in life, and I know it can be hard, and I know you deal with lots of heavy, heavy things, and I just want to know, how do you overcome the stress of the moment, of all your responsibilities? And he got really stoic for a moment, and he leaned into the question, and what followed was one of the greatest lessons I've perhaps ever learned in life. And I'm going to share with you the nugget that he gave us. He told a story of a time where they had a block party for the kids in his little corner of New Orleans. And there was this one kid that came running up to him and says, Dr. Fred. And he was tugging on his pants like, Dr. Fred. And he pointed to a kid over in the corner. He stole my Kool-Aid. And the kid was passionate. And Dr. Fred was about to share the gospel. And he reaches into his pocket and he pulls out a couple of $1 bills and he says, give me your hand. And he stuck those $1 bills in that kid's hand and says, put that money in your pocket. He says, when you go home, you tell her that Dr. Fred said to buy you all the Kool-Aid you want. And then here was the nugget of truth that really, I think, changed my life. And he said this, refuse to allow the enemy to steal what God has gifted you. Refuse to allow the enemy to steal what God has gifted you. And in that moment, all of us were writing down those words. And for many of us, they changed our life forever. And I wonder right now, maybe, just maybe, if someone who's listening, and the marriage, instead of being sizzling, is ice cold, and you've let the circumstances of that relationship rob you of your joy. Or maybe, just maybe, there's some of you right now, because of COVID-19, and you lost your job, and you took a job that you hate, but you're in it to provide for your family, but the attitude and the joy, well, your attitude hadn't been great, and the joy hadn't been there. Maybe, just maybe, you live next door to someone. And the person that you live next door to, if we can just be so bold this morning, you don't like them. And maybe they don't like you. And maybe when you come home at the end of the day, you have disdain in your heart because you see them instead of love in your heart because Christ died for them. I want to invite you to do something today. I want to invite you to give all those circumstances to Christ and allow Him to rebirth an eternal joy in your heart. Let's bring this home with a question today. Is your joy connected to your circumstances or to Jesus? Is your joy connected to your circumstances or Jesus? Now, how can you determine which one you're connected to? Does your mood go up or down based on how people treat you or what happens at work or how the kids behave, then that's circumstantial joy. But if you're able to remain constant through the highs and lows of life, then your joy is connected, you guessed it, to Jesus, because Jesus has always been constant in my life and in your life as well. Okay, perhaps you've made decisions today. As always, we want you to text those decisions, whatever they may be, to Next Steps, one word, Next Steps, one word, to 95577. You know, the Bible says today that we're all in the same boat. All of us, spiritually speaking, are in the same boat. We all have a need for a Savior. And the reason that we have a need for a Savior is we're all born with a heart deficiency, spiritually speaking, and that deficiency is sin. The Bible says all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. The wages, the consequences, or penalty of that sin is death. But the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. It would be awesome if that was your decision today. For some of you, this is your decision. You're hitting the reset button because, like Dr. Fred said, you've given the enemy your joy instead of embraced it from your Savior. Some of you need to hit the reset button and you need to choose to focus on the Christ in your circumstances and not simply your circumstances. Let's pray. Lord, you're good and you're great. And we love you only because you first loved us. And we ask today, as best we know how, help us to reflect your love and your light to our community. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Wow, thanks for that great message, Dr. Bird. Even though the world promises happiness, we know that we can only receive eternal joy through Jesus. Now, let's close today by saying our commitment together. You will never suffer at my hands. I will never say nor do anything knowingly to hurt you. If you're down and I can lift you up, I'll do that. I will always, in every circumstance, seek to help and support you. If you need something and I have it, I'll give it to you. No matter what I find out about you, no matter what happens in the future, either good or bad, my commitment to you will never change. Thanks again for joining us. We hope you have a great day.